Well, folks, it is good to be back. We had a beautiful little holiday after a little bit of work in Tasmania. Really enjoyed St. John's Presbyterian Church in Hobart. If you're visiting there, it's worth a visit on a Sunday morning. And then we came back for a week and worked in the backyard and went along to church at Wilston with Stuart and Kathy Atkinson. And those of you with long memories will be aware that a number of years ago now, we sort of helped and encouraged Wilston get restarted with Stuart and Kathy leading. And it was just delightful to see how that church is going. It's really buzzing, lots of young families and kids. And we should be really encouraged, I think, to see that happening. So here we are. I appreciate Doug O'Donnell's work the last couple of weeks in Proverbs. It was good to have him. And we pick up this morning in the book of Ecclesiastes, page 662. And over 2 weeks, we're going to be getting a bird's eye view of Ecclesiastes. So we're going to start reading at the beginning of chapter 1 and read through to verse 11 in chapter 2. We might go to verse 16 in chapter 2. The words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. What do people gain from all their labours at which they toil under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets and hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the streams come from, there they return again. All things are wearisome, more than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear its fill of hearing. What has been will be again. What's been done will be done again. There's nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, look, this is something new? It was here already long ago. It was here before our time. No one remembers the former generations, and even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them. I, the teacher, was king over Israel in Jerusalem. I applied my mind to study and to explore by wisdom all that is done under the heavens. What a heavy burden God has laid on mankind. I've seen all the things that are done under the sun. All of them are meaningless, are chasing after the wind. What is crooked cannot be straightened. What is lacking cannot be counted. I said to myself, look, I've increased in wisdom more than anyone who's ruled over Jerusalem before me. I've experienced much of wisdom and knowledge. Then I applied myself to the understanding of wisdom and also of madness and folly. But I learned that this too is a chasing after the wind. For with much wisdom comes much sorrow. The more knowledge, the more grief. I said to myself, come now, I will test you with pleasure to find out what is good. But that also proved to be meaningless. Laughter, I said, is madness. And what does pleasure accomplish? I tried cheering myself with wine and embracing folly, my mind still guiding me with wisdom. I wanted to see what was good for people to do under the heavens during the few days of their lives. I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself and planted vineyards. I made gardens and parks and planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made reservoirs to water groves of flourishing trees. I bought male and female slaves and had other slaves who were born in my house. I also owned more herds and flocks than anyone in Jerusalem before me. I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasure of kings and provinces. I acquired male and female singers and a harem as well, the delights of a man's heart. I became greater by far than anyone in Jerusalem before me. In all this, my wisdom stayed with me. I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my labour, and this was the reward for all my toil. Yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. Nothing was gained under the sun. Then I turned my thoughts to consider wisdom and also madness and folly. What more can the king's successor do than what is already being done? I saw that wisdom is better than folly, just as light is better than darkness. The wise have eyes in their heads while the fool walks in the darkness. But I came to realise that the same fate overtakes them both. Then I said to myself, the fate of the fool will overtake me also. What then do I gain by being wise? I said to myself, this too is meaningless, for the wise, like the fool, will not be long remembered. The days have already come when both have been forgotten. Like the fool, the wise too must die. Well, that's enough to get us started. Probably more than enough. Now let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we consider the words before us this morning, we pray that indeed we would understand the darkness but see a shaft of light through it. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm not sure if it's still there, but if you've been to New York, I wonder if you ever saw the giant-sized poster of Donald Trump. It was apparently 60 metres wide, and there it was, just his face, a billboard advertising nothing except him, with only one word, 3 metres high under his jaw, Trump. Back in 1818, Percy Shelley wrote these words, a famous poem called The Ode to Ozymandias. He said, I met a traveller from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read which yet survive stamped on these lifeless things. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed, and on the pedestal these words appear, my name is Ozymandias, King of Kings, look on my works ye mighty and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. In other words, a guy builds an awesome monument to himself so he'll never be forgotten. Now it's just a broken down wreck, half buried in sand. That's life. Donald Trump can look out the window of his office and point to all the skyscrapers that he owns, Trump Place, Trump World Tower, which when it was built was the tallest residential tower in the world. But you know, if he thinks even stuff like that guarantees that he will make his mark in history, that he'll be remembered, he needs to think again. You can build whatever you like, but somehow it seems the lone and level sands always win. Which is, in a nutshell, the book of Ecclesiastes. Ever read it? This little mini-series we're in at the moment, Light in the Darkness, it is a quick glimpse of this part of the Old Testament called the Wisdom Literature. And just to gear you up for what's coming today and next week, the book of Ecclesiastes takes us on a very long, guided tour of the darkness before we get to see any light at all. At points, it is so dark, you might wonder if there's any way out of it. It's a book that asks the Donald Trump question, how do I make my mark? And the answer might surprise you. Ecclesiastes, it is a kind of mysterious, semi-anonymous book because the writer never actually tells us his name. He calls himself the teacher at the start of the book, which is where the name of the book Ecclesiastes comes from. That's what the word actually means, the teacher. But he does drop a few clues, or so it seems, like he's one of the kings of Israel, a son of David. Now, lots of people assume that it might be written by King Solomon, which it could be, but he never actually says so. The trouble is, with what you can figure out from the biblical accounts of the life of King Solomon, he is a highly ambiguous guy, famous for his wisdom, but of course equally famous for his ungodliness. Though there is an old Jewish legend that at the end of his life, Solomon turned back to God because he'd learnt the hard way what was important and what wasn't. Maybe you can try imagining that kind of scenario as you read and see if it fits. All we get for sure are the words you see there in chapter 1, verse 1, the words of the teacher, son of David, king of Jerusalem. And this teacher, as it turns out, he is setting out on the search for meaning. He is looking for satisfaction. He's looking for purpose. He is looking for what makes life worth living, which is a quest he explains if you jump ahead to verse 13. That's where he spells out his goal. He's going to run a series of lab tests to see if he can find out what works, with himself as the human guinea pig. He says, I set out to explore by wisdom all that's done under heaven. He's going to try test after test after test, looking for answers. Now, I don't know where you're up to on that search yet, or whether you've really even started it, whether you maybe just gave up. But if you're a thinking person, you will be asking these questions, which is what makes Ecclesiastes such a great book to read, because it is the account of what this one guy finds as he goes prodding all the things that ordinary people do to find out what it is that makes life worth living. And you know what he finds? Well, of course, he tells us right from the start. This is not one of those clickbait headlines, you know, that you've got to wait for the ad break or click to go to another page, because it is all there in his very next words in chapter 1. Meaningless, meaningless. If you go through the whole book and highlight it, you'll find he uses exactly that word over and over and over again, 35 times in total, meaningless, meaningless, meaningless. He says he's looking for meaning, and he finds none. As far as the teacher can see, there's nothing in this limited world worth doing. Meaningless, meaningless. Sometimes the teacher says it the way he says it here in verse 14. He says it's all just meaningless, like chasing the wind. But that doesn't mean he's going to stop looking. So here is the first big lab test, the pleasure test. Now, I'm sure there are no shortage of volunteers to sign up for that one. Take a look. He says, I said to myself, come now, I'll test you with pleasure to find out what is good. He'll drink. He'll laugh. He'll muck around with his mates. We're at the start of chapter 2. But that also, he says, proves to be meaningless. Now, look, don't try telling that to George from MasterChef. I saw in the paper yesterday, Q Weekend magazine, they were asking George the question, among other questions, that they asked, what's the point of life? Same question the teacher's asking. And George says the point of life is 100% enjoyment. Teacher says, tried that, didn't work. Meaningless. George says, well, not just that, down the next sentence, he says, it's about pushing ourselves every day and making a difference. Teacher says, chapter 2 from verse 4, I undertook great projects. I built houses for myself. I planted vineyards, made gardens and parks, planted all kinds of fruit trees in them. I made reservoirs to water groves of flourishing trees. Did what I could to make a difference. He goes on, pushing himself every day. Every achievement, every pleasure, 100% enjoyment. And the verdict is this, chapter 2, verse 11, yet when I surveyed everything my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, chasing after the wind. So no matter what he tries, wisdom, pleasure, work, same result. Right through, in fact, to chapter 12, verse 8. This is an easy book to give an overview of. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Everything is meaningless. Now, look, I've got to say we do need to spend a moment thinking about that actual word, the word translated meaningless there, because in a sense it is the key to the whole book, and it's kind of difficult to translate from the original Hebrew, and there is some debate about it among scholars. The old English King James Version used the word vanity, 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 all is vanity. The original Hebrew word is the word hebel, which most literally means breath or vapour, steam. Don't know if that helps at all or makes you feel any better about it. I tried everything in life, it's all just a puff of smoke. I mean, I think the teacher pretty much defines it himself when he says it is like chasing after the wind, which is a phrase that he uses 9 times through the book. Have you tried that? Have you ever caught the wind? Now, I remember someone said to me last time I spoke on Ecclesiastes years ago, he said, you know, this guy's got a problem. It's too dark. But look, here's the problem. Come back again for a closer look at chapter 1 and have a look at one of the key reasons why he says what he says. Chapter 1, pick up in verse 2 again, meaningless. Wisps of smoke, says the teacher. Everything is meaningless. What does a man gain from all his labour which he toils under the sun? That is the question. What makes life worth living? Why bother getting up in the morning and going off to uni? Why drag yourself out of bed for another day at work? Why not just stay in bed? And of course, if you're a typical Australian, just try not to think about it. Just do it. Or else you'll be working from the basis of some sort of trite little answer that your parents gave you, like, well, we're working hard for the kids to give them a good education. Well, why? Why is that so important? Well, so they can get a good job. Why? Well, so they can work hard for their kids to give them a good education. Why? Round it goes. Now, that is the kind of cycle you see if you keep reading in chapter 1. Verse 3, you see, question. What do people gain from all their labour at which they toil under the sun? And his answer, when you get down to it, is absolutely nothing. Verse 4, generations come and generations go, he says. The sun rises, the sun sets, the wind blows south, the wind blows north. Round and round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. It's just like a giant treadmill. It's like a rat in a cage. The streams run into the sea and back again. There used to be a pop song, "All My Life's a Circle, Sunrise and Sundown. The years are spinning round again. They just keep rolling around." Then, of course, Disney came out with Circle of Life. That's what he's saying through to verse 8. But it is a tiring cycle. All things are wearisome. More than one can say, the grindstone grinds you down. Now, if you've been working for more than a few years, you'll know the feeling. You do your work today, there's more tomorrow. Solve one set of problems this week, there are more next week. You go to work, you come home from work, you go to work, you come. It's a daily grind. Once a week you mow the lawn, once a year you wash the car. Or is that just me? Over and over again. But you know, the little stream trying to fill the ocean, they're never going to make it. Life on the treadmill, the rat in a cage. The reality is, says the teacher, that's what it's like. Do you reckon it's worth it? If you're under 25, you're still only on the first few loops. It's still fun watching the scenery go round. 40, maybe starting to wear a bit thin. 50, 60, 70, 80, 90. You know, it's not going to get any better. Like he says in verse 8, all things are wearisome, more than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, the ear its fill of hearing. What has been will be again, what's been done will be done again. There's nothing new under the sun. You know, worse than that, no matter how much you might think you achieve, when you're gone, you're going to be forgotten. Sure as eggs. Back to Master Chef George again. He says this. The opportunity of MasterChef has allowed me to leave a legacy to the food world. To walk down the street and run into tradies with hard hats who show you the macarons they made on the weekend with their kids. He says, that is awesome. So George is saying, I guess the real point of life is to leave a legacy, to make your mark. You walk down the street, you see the people whose lives you've changed, that you've somehow touched. You know, James Baker used to be the US Secretary of State. One of the most important jobs in the world. Just a stroke of a pen, he could change almost anything. He could affect every person on the planet. But he said, you know, the legacy that he would make, it came home to him one day, driving through Washington, D.C. Because as he looks out the window of his black limo, he sees a lonely old man shuffling along the street on the footpath on his own. No one recognises him, except James Baker from his car. And he says, it suddenly struck me, I recognised him, it was my predecessor, the Secretary of State who came before me, retired, forgotten. Nobody knew him. Nobody cared. Chapter 2, verse 11. No one remembers the former generations, and even those who are yet to come won't be remembered by those who follow them. Donald Trump, it's true. George, it's true. You think the meaning in life is going to come from making your mark? Think again. As somebody else once said, the words on your tombstone might as well be written with a finger in the water. Same with your achievements. This teacher, he's been around enough times that he's checked it out because he's looked at life, and that is the verdict. Life is like a puff of smoke. All my life's a circle, round and round, up and down. Fun at first, but you've been around the loop the amount of times he has. He's seen it all before. So I guess you see, if you reckon work's boring, you're right. If you reckon one day just blurs pretty much into the next, you're right. If you reckon generations come and generations go and a couple of hundred years you won't even be remembered, you're right. If your name is Ozymandias and you've just commissioned a giant statue of yourself and you think it's going to stand forever, think again. And in verse 13 in chapter 1, the teacher who says, I devoted myself to study and explore by wisdom all that is done under heaven, says this. He says, what a heavy burden God has laid on mankind. I've seen all the things that are done under the sun. All of them are meaningless, chasing after the wind. All the things that the world wants to say are the things we should chase after. The teacher says, meaningless, meaningless, meaningless. Trying to get your fingers around a gust of wind. And look, by the time we get to the end of Ecclesiastes, by the end of our little two-week tour next week, we will be crying out for something better. By the time we get to the end of Ecclesiastes, we will be utterly convinced that living life just for the sake of this world, the world the teacher calls life under the sun, the world that is hemmed in by death at one end, birth at the beginning. If it's just that, he says, it is not worth it. You know, Doug O'Donnell gave a very good reminder last week, and I hope you've been reminded lots of times before, that the reason we Christians have got the Old Testament, the reason we go to the Old Testament scriptures like Ecclesiastes, it is very, very simple. Paul says to his apprentice Timothy in the New Testament, a key verse in the New Testament, he says, you know, Timothy, the Old Testament scriptures are hugely useful for one key reason. He says to Timothy, from infancy you've known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. If Ecclesiastes leaves you with lots of questions, if Ecclesiastes leaves you longing for more, good. I want to say to you now, the only place that you're going to find answers is in Jesus himself and faith in him. The one who breaks through the barrier from God to man, breaks through the cycles of meaningless, breaks the cycle of birth, then death, then nothing. And he answers the question that's screaming through the pages of Ecclesiastes, the question that's put most clearly in Ecclesiastes chapter 6, verse 12, we'll put it on the screen. The question is, for who knows what is good for a person in life during the few and meaningless days they pass through like a shadow? Who can tell them what will happen under the sun after they are gone? See, we can answer that. Who knows? Well, there is someone who can answer exactly that question. And there is someone who is an absolutely reliable guide to what happens next. And there is someone who can tell you where to invest, not just for this life, but for the next. And the darkness of the question in Ecclesiastes, surely, that is going to make you long for some light. The one with answers, I'm talking about the one who in Mark chapter 8, verse 36 says, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? What's the use of winning everything if you're going to lose it all? What's the good of having the top degrees, the best job, the biggest house, the flashiest car, the great holidays, the respectable family, the brand name clothes? What's the good in the end if you're going to forfeit the lot and your soul as well? The one who said those words, of course, is Jesus Christ. And if you are ready to hear from him, when you're ready to trust him, then there is a radical reshaping of what's really important. You know, we are living in what former Deputy Prime Minister John Anderson called this week a cut flower culture. Looks impressive and colourful for a while, just detached from the roots. So it's just going to wilt and die. And nobody wants to think about consequences. Nobody really wants to ask questions about meaning and purpose anymore. In fact, it's a culture purpose built to stop people asking these kinds of questions. The question that the teacher in Ecclesiastes is putting front and centre. Don't think about meaning, it's too depressing. Have another drink. Make some more money. Have some more sex. Fill in your time, fill up your head, make your mark in the sand and be satisfied with that. Just whatever you do, don't ask the hard questions. But the bottom line is, if this life is all there is, if it's just a matter of what you see is what you get, then at least stare it in the eye. At least be honest. At least ask the questions, which is exactly what the teacher's doing. Ultimately, again, I want to say, and I'll say more next week, it is only Jesus, I'm convinced, who has the answers. Next week, we'll see why. It's only Jesus who can cut through the cycle of meaningless. It's only Jesus who will put the price tags in the right places. See, the trouble is if you're not first going to be troubled by the teacher and ask the hard questions, then you won't be ready for the answers that hopefully we'll get a glimpse of next time. I do want to ask you today, if you haven't already, will you take the Ecclesiastes challenge? Will you ask yourself the tough questions, whether you're a Christian already or whether you're not, and put your lifestyle and your life goals and your life ambitions to the test? Read right through the book in one sitting. It's only 12 chapters. Only take a few minutes. And think through your own answers to those tough questions between now and next week. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the way your word provokes us to be people of wisdom. And we pray indeed that through these weeks, as we consider this part of your word, you would help us to think deeply and reflectively in a way that makes us wise for the salvation we have in Christ Jesus. We pray this in his name. Amen.